May the Lord bless you.
May the Lord keep you.
May the Lord make his face to shine upon you.
And give you peace. Hey, friends,
we are
blessed. Thank you.
Tumble out of bed and I stumble to the kitchen. Pour myself a cup of ambition and yawn and stretch and try to come to life. Jump in the shower and the blood starts pumping. Out on the streets the traffic starts jumping. With folks like me on the job from 9 to 5.
Working 9 to 5. What a way.
Want to move on.
watch him shatter. You're just a step on the boss man's ladder, but you got dreams he'll never take away. In the same boat with a lot of your friends, waiting for the day your ship will come in, and the tide's gonna turn and it's all gonna roll your way.
Working 9 to 5, what a way to make a living, barely getting by. It's all taking and no giving. They just use your mind and you never get the credit. It's enough to drive you crazy if you let it. 9 to 5, yeah, they got you where they want you. There's a better life and you think about it, don't you? It's a rich man's game, no matter what they call.
Well, welcome to God First, and it might be Sunday morning for you, or it might be at some other point in the week when you're watching this, but we want to say you are so warmly welcome. It might be that you're a regular here at God First. You are so welcome. It might be that you're looking in from perhaps even another nation, or just joining us for the first time, or starting to connect with us. We want to say you are so warmly welcome to be with us. You know, the truth is that God wants to encounter you. Why? Because he's in the people business and he loves you. And the truth is, again, that God wants to bring you home. And he's provided a way for that to happen through his dear son, Jesus Christ, his death, his resurrection. And there's an invitation for you to come home today if you don't know him. If you want prayer, if you want to encounter God, if you want someone to speak to you via our live chat rooms, you can just click the live prayer button and you can do that. And someone connect with you, or it might be that you're watching this at another time. If you go to our website, you can click our contact card and someone would be in contact with you. We just want to serve and help you and introduce you to Jesus. So we've got a packed morning. We've got Ginny leading worship for us, which is going to be great. And later on, we've got an interview relating to our Academy for Supernatural Transformation. And Emma Slater and Mornay are going to be chatting about that. And so loads to enjoy this morning. So why don't we hand straight over to Ginny, over to her lounge, and let's worship God. I would just encourage you, press into him. If you position yourself for encounter, he is a God who will come close to us by his Holy Spirit. So God bless you. Let's worship the Lord of Lords.
Good morning, everybody. It's great to be here, part of the worship team this morning, coming live from our house, directly into your homes or wherever you are this morning. We just want to worship God this morning, to give him all the glory, all the honour and all the praise. And so however you're feeling this morning, whether you want to jump up and shout for joy, whether you want to clap along, whether you want to sit or stand, or just remain silent and worship him, please do whatever works for you. But let's worship our God. He's such a good God.
Thank you.
such a good God. You are mighty, you are victorious, and we love you, Lord.
This is Monet and Emma on the call today. Today, this our session is on scattered servants. And one of the things we talk about as a church is to be a transformed people that transform the world. And so one of the key aspects of actually going into the world, whatever our world might look like, whether it's family or college, school, or business, whatever, is that, you know, as we transform that space with the kingdom of God, is how are we first, as a people, transformed into the likeness of Jesus. And so today in our call, we want to talk to Emma, who runs our Academy for Supernatural Transformation. And so we want to just talk a little bit about that and positioning ourselves so that we can be a transformed person. And so, hi, Emma. Welcome.
Hello.
Welcome to this call. Thank you for joining me.
Thank you.
So we've got a few minutes just to quickly chat about the Academy. How long have we been running the Academy at God First for now?
So we're going actually into our fourth year, which is really, really exciting. So we're just coming to the end of our third year, and in October that will be the start of our fourth year of our Academy.
Right. And so currently, how many students would you have on the course right now?
So we have 38 students on the course this year. So we have probably half or more than half are from God First this year, which has just been fantastic to kind of journey with our own family. We love having people from all over. We have people that have travelled as far from Exeter or from Newbury over the past years. So we're really excited to have people with us wherever they're from, but it's always a little bit more special when you've got people from your own family with you. It's just great.
Absolutely. And tell us a little bit about what you do at the Academy and sort of what it's about in relation to transforming the individual.
Sure. Well, I think one of the kind of unique things about a course like the Academy is that it's over a 9-month period, which can seem, it is a huge commitment and it can seem like a really long time. Yeah. But actually, often when we journey things through, or we process things through with God over a period of time, we just kind of get, we're able to take things a little bit deeper. We're able to come through a little bit stronger on some things. We then also just have the benefit of time and the benefit of time of being together regularly, week after week, with each other. So that's quite a unique thing about the Academy, that it doesn't run just for 10 or 12 weeks. It's not a kind of flash in the pan experience. This is something that you really do feel like you go from a beginning point and an end point. You do feel like you can, over that period of time, you can come all the way through on a number of things that have maybe been kind of getting in the cogs of your life, that have been maybe you're coming all the way through on some really transformational things and liberating things like fear or anxiety. We teach a lot at the Academy. Really our principal teachings are on who God is and who does he say we are and how can we model our life after Jesus. And when we concentrate on those things and focus on those things for a period of time, it can't help but have an incredible transformational effect on our lives. So that's one unique element about the Academy.
Yes. Wow. Can you just share maybe one or two quick stories about, you know, how people have engaged with the Academy and how it's impacted their lives?
Yeah, absolutely. We had somebody in that first year who'd been living with depression and anxiety for a very, very long time, and then had been getting regular support through medication and counselling and different things like that. And they were living their life well. It wasn't like they were failing or not being able to manage their life. But God just broke in supernaturally sort of towards the end of that first year and totally broke that off her life. And suddenly she was able to sleep in a way a little time later she came off medication, and she's just, her life has done a complete 180. She's living really, really differently.
Wow, fantastic.
Amazing. And so over the... Yeah, and so over the years, we really believe that what God has done, he'll do again. So on every year, we take those incredible stories of breakthrough or faith, and we just stand on those and ask God for more. And so that's what we've seen, actually, in year two and year three. We've seen an increase and a kind of a momentum of God doing things. So we've seen marriages restored. We've seen people set free from mental health difficulties. We've seen people break free from fear.
Fantastic. Okay, well, listen, we're running out of time, so just sure. I mean there's so many great stories that you guys have. I know you got like loads and loads. I mean, trying to pull a few out, but
yeah.
And so I'm trusting if you listen to this and you think you're stirred, I would encourage you to sign up to the academy. So Emma, how can people now get involved, or if they want to know more about the academy, yeah, what can they do now?
Well, there's a couple of things actually that they can do. So if you guys are really feeling that this might be something for you this year, then I would recommend going to our God First website, and on the homepage there should be something there for the academy. And on the Find Out More button, you can just click on that, and that will take you through to a page that will show you all the information for the year coming, all the dates for the year ahead. And there's more stories on the website about people's journeys, and also it will give you information about the fees. And at the moment, we've got an early bird price where there's a £30 reduction on the fees until the end of May. So I'd make the most of that offer if you could. And secondly, we've got an open evening that's going to be, we normally would have an open evening where people would come and visit us. So we still wanted people to come and visit us and spend some time with us, even though at the moment we're currently meeting via Zoom, which I have to say is good fun.
Yeah.
It's been going well. So on the 11th of June, you are invited to come and Zoom in with us for the evening. And we will be having, there'll be information, again, if you go to the homepage of our God First website and find out more, there'll be information about our open evening and how to connect with us via Zoom, all on the website that you get linked into.
Great. Well, Emma, thank you. Just want to honor you and your team for your weekly commitment to the course, to the people that's there, and you know, people's lives being impacted and their families and whatever else they engaged in. So just we'll keep blessing you guys as you do that. Amen. And so, so guys, if you want to know more, like Emma said, click onto the website. We would love to have a conversation with you about it. So Lord bless you into this week.
Well, thank you, Ginny, for leading us in worship. So good to be in God's presence together as we honour the King of Kings. And I think it's just good, even wherever we are, whether it's in our lounges, whether we're on our own, whether we're with others around us, just to know that God is with us. Hallelujah. Also, fantastic to hear about the Academy for Supernatural Transformation. You know, as I think about this, I think, what is it that believers in these days really need to be equipped for if we're to see the Great Commission fulfilled? And I think there's probably three key things. It's this, it's we're to know our God as Father. That's just so wonderful, that truth. Secondly, I think we've got to know our identity as sons or daughters in Christ. Really important, we know that. And then thirdly, to know that we are appointed and assigned to be architects of change in our community. The way the Bible talks about that is that we're to be Kingdom of God bringers. And so the Academy is helping us exactly do that. And I honestly think this, I think the Academy is part of us getting our inheritance as a church to the things that God has promised us. And I would tell you, and I would ask you, if you've not signed up for that, sign up for it. I'm signing up this year just because I want to keep pressing on with God and keep growing. So I want to talk to you about a couple of other things. One is about our offering. That's a moment that we can give financially now. And if you click on your screen, if you're watching this on the Church Online platform, there's opportunity. You can click a button to give. And that really takes you through to our website. So the easiest way to give is to go through to our website and click giving, and you can give there. And we don't want to go on about money, or we're not demanding money. We're simply saying this, that one of the ways that the scripture speaks about worshiping God is through our giving. And somehow our generosity to God reflects how warm warm our hearts are towards God. That's why Jesus spoke on money more than he spoke on heaven and hell combined, actually. And so it's an incredibly important thing because it reflects the heart of trust and following God. It's not about keeping the lights on or paying the utility bills. This is about the heart of discipleship. And so just encourage you towards that. And it might be that you've not yet been able to transfer your physical giving that you were giving to online. And we would say if you're a regular with us that we would encourage you to do that. Or if you're looking in, feel free to give. We'll use it to lift Jesus' name high. That's what we'll do with it. I just want to highlight the Alpha course to you. You probably heard about the Alpha course. It's a brilliant way of exploring Christianity. So if you're looking in at this video and you want to find out more about Jesus, more about what Christians believe, more about what it means to you in everyday life, the Alpha course is for you. So if you go from here and click on the godfirst.church website, you can find the Alpha course banner there and all the information's there. If you're a regular at God First, I'm asking you to do two simple things. One of the things I'm asking you to do is pray about at least two or three people, or maybe more, that you can specifically invite by name and ask them to come along. I'm going to be hosting the course. It's going to be the first time we've done it online, but I know it's going to be great. It's going to be brilliant, and I think it's going to be easy. The second thing I'm asking you to do is this: flood social media with it. Go onto our God First Facebook page, like it, share it on your own story, use the email that I've sent to you, but just flood it so it's out there. We've already got probably three people looking in at doing the course before we've even really got any of our advertisement out. So this is the first time that the course really will be run without any geographic boundaries. People can come literally from the other side of the world onto a Zoom call and explore Christianity through the Alpha course online. So really easy, so go for it. That's going to be amazing. And so finally now, without further ado, I want to hand over to Shirley. Shirley, we're rooting for you. Thank you for opening the word for us. Thank you for using that teaching gift that you've got. Thank you for that you're going to bring truth to us. And let's be ready to receive this foundational truth that Shirley's going to open up from the word of God for us. So over to your lounge, Shirley. Go for it. And let's receive as Shirley teaches and preaches now.
The church is incredible.
It has seen the rise and fall of empires.
The development of science and technology.
It witnessed wars between nations and people groups.
It has endured natural disasters such as earthquakes, famines,
tsunamis to plagues.
And yet the church keeps growing.
Why is this?
Come and explore with us the foundations of a thriving church.
In every culture and generation,
regardless of the challenges it faces.
Come join our
preaching series,
Reset.
Good morning or good evening, depending on when you're joining us. Welcome to my lounge, where we're just going to be exploring the Word of God together this morning. We're continuing in our Refresh series, where we're looking at some of the foundational elements that made up the life of the early church. And hopefully, as we explore, we're going to find ourselves inspired and challenged and taught. But before we go to the book of Acts, I want to tell you a little known fact about myself. I have a favourite animal. And it's not a big lion or a cuddly panda bear. My favourite animal is the wolf. Wolves are amazing, magnificent creatures. Free and wild and beautiful, they live in some of the most remote corners of the planet. But the thing that really fascinates me about them, the thing that makes me watch them time and time again on nature programs, on the TV, or in real life, if ever I get the opportunity, is the incredible social structure of the pack. Wolves are considered to be one of the most social creatures on the planet. They're not this kind of angry, snarling big dog that's only out for itself. Wolves exist within a truly beautiful community. It's highly organised, well-disciplined, and remarkably amicable as they work together for the good of the pack. Okay, they have their squabbles and they might fail sometimes and have a bit of pain or whatever it happens to be. But in a weird sort of way, wolves display a powerful and connected, effective community. And I love to watch community. I think other people do. That's why we watch soap operas. That's why we sit in cafes and watch the world go by and watch social interaction. I know I'm not alone. Interestingly, the TV series Friends, that tells about three guys and three girls who live in New York in apartments, was one of the most successful TV sitcoms of all time. Netflix said it was the most downloaded program for 3 years in a row, and it's won a plethora of awards. What was this success down to? Okay, it was quite funny and it had wacky and interesting storylines. But the experts say that the success of the sitcom Friends was put down to the fact that it portrayed what every human heart truly longs for: community and connection. Total strangers who come together, who become friends, and then form true, authentic community. A community where they were interlinked and holy together. Community, it would appear, is a big thing. And if there's one thing that this season of COVID, this stay-at-home time, has done, is it's made me think about my own community, made me realise how much I value my family and my friends. A little bit of distance makes the heart grow fonder, I think. But it's this concept of community that we're going to be exploring today as we look at the evolving church in its infancy in the book of Acts. Luke, the author of the Gospel of Luke, who also wrote the book of Acts, is continuing to tell the story of the life of Jesus as it's outworked in the early church and the presence of the powerful and beautiful Holy Spirit. It's the story of the church in its earliest days, some key fundamental elements and firm foundations that have meant the church has continued through generations and centuries across countries and cultures and lands to expand and thrive right up until today. And so we pick the story up in Acts chapter 2, verse 42. So if you've got your Bibles, you can either open them or switch them on. Here we go. And they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. This is the early church we're talking about. And awe came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles. And all who believed were together. Say the word together. It's not too weird. And had all things in common. Say the word common. And they were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing the proceeds to all, any who had need. And day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes, they received their food with gladness and generous hearts, praising God and having favour with all the people. And the Lord added to their number those who were being saved. This passage, above many others in Scripture, shows us something of the life and community of the early church. It tells us a little bit about what it looked like, about how it functioned. And frankly, it paints a very attractive picture. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. And Mornay unpacked that a little bit for us last week. And that teaching would have mainly revolved around the fact that Jesus Christ was risen and he was alive and he was resurrected. It would have talked a little bit about Christ's life, some of his teachings. It would have told of the parables and the miracles that would have happened. And as we look through scriptures, we realise that the apostles' teaching also goes on to deal with matters around the formation of the church and the outworking of Jesus's incredible promises. They ate together, they shared communion together, they had an attitude of joy and thankfulness. They prayed together, and we can see lots of examples of that throughout the book of Acts and into the New Testament. But they also were together and had all things in common. Now, I know that many of you will have already read this passage so many times in your life, and it's easy with a passage like this just to let it brush over us. But I think if we do that, we will miss something quite fundamental that Luke was trying to show us. And what we're going to do is we're going to unpack two of those words. We're going to have a look at this word together. We're going to have a look at this word common. So the word together in the original language this book was written in Old Testament Greek, in New Testament Greek rather, is epeautoauto, and it means of the same place. It means togetherness, and it expresses connection and unity and harmony. The word common is in the Greek is koinonia, and many of us would have heard that word as to meaning fellowship or communion. And that depicts an image of shared activity and mutual activity. But what is really fascinating about that word is that it has much deeper overtones. So the word koinonia is used in other parts of scripture in the New Testament, but it's actually translated unclean or impure, which seems bizarre. But what the writers are trying to tell us is that there is an absolute grassroots commonness, a nitty gritty salt of the earth, basic level to the community that the early church shared. Luke wasn't speaking about some airy-fairy little house on the prairie sort of shallow Walnut Grove community. Luke wants us to know that this was a community that was raw and primal and basic and functioned at the most basic level. Today we would use words like real community, genuine community, authentic community, honest community. But Bible commentators want us to know that these two words together, in the way that they're put together in that passage, leaves us with no doubt that this is a truly authentic community that operates at a rudimental level. And the outworking of this community is quite stunning. The most obvious thing that we first see is their absolute generosity. In Acts chapter 4, it says this of the early church: all believers were one in heart and mind. No one claimed that any of their possessions was their own, but they shared everything they had. With great power, the apostles continued to testify to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and God's grace was so powerfully at work in all of them that there were no needy persons amongst them. From time to time, those who owned land or houses sold them, bought their money from the sales, and put it at the apostles' feet. And it was distributed to anyone who had need. Wow. Like, that doesn't challenge me. Like, that doesn't make me think, gosh, that community of the early church was incredible. It's not the only thing we see at working in the early church. Yes, they were generous, but there was other things happening as well. Acts chapter 12, where Peter is in prison, it says that the community were gathered and they were earnestly praying for him, so that they supported each other in other ways. And when eventually the angel let Peter out of prison, it was to the community that he went. They sheltered him and they kept him actually at risk to their own lives. Acts 2:46 says that day by day they attended the temple together. There was a commonality and a consistency and a rhythm and a focus of life that was brought to the early church. It was a community of the early church that strengthened and helped provide for Paul in his missionary journeys as he spread out across Asia and into Europe. We learn that they cared for widows and for orphans, that they learned together and grew together in fear of the Lord and in faith. And they had a community that was made up of people from different backgrounds and different parts of society and different levels of life. Tim Keller, a well-known Christian Bible teacher, says this, that this sort of community was totally unprecedented in its day. So normally within their society, everybody stuck to their own little tribes and didn't really mix. But the church became this mixture of people from different ethnicities and different backgrounds and different social standings. And it was incredible. If you go beyond scripture to some of the early historical writings, you'll find that the early church was known for its huge hospitality towards social outcasts and the poor. It says of the early church that when disease or famine hit lands, it was often the early church that stayed within the communities, caring for the sick and the destitute, sometimes at cost of their own lives. And it was in the context of this early church that people looked on, and the Bible says many were added to their number. Cultural anthropologists, say anthropologist just because you can, anthropologist. Cultural anthropologists, people that basically study various cultures and people groups, say this: there are two types of social communities. There is a weak group society and there is a strong group society. In the strong group society, a person sees himself as a member of the group and is responsible to the group for their destiny, for their career choices, for their life in general. They can see themselves embedded within the group, and they only act in a way that is either beneficial to the group, acts in the group's best interest, or is similar to what the group considers to be normal. This group prioritises the group over the individual. And there are cultures like that around the world today. You can often see that in Africa or in South America, or especially in Asia, in places like Korea, where this strong group identity, this strong group culture still exists. A weak group culture is made up of individuals whose priority is individual choice, personal rights. And although they identify with the group, they're really rather on the outside of it, looking in rather than being embedded in the middle. This weak group society has the needs of the individual as priority over the needs of the group, or the thoughts of the group, or the opinions of the group, or the benefit of the group. I want to suggest that when we look at the early church in the book of Acts, what we are actually looking at is a strong group culture. People who saw themselves as having a common grassroots responsibility for each other, where everyone cared for the needs of others sacrificially and others cared for them. The emphasis is on one another rather than on the individual. And that's interesting, of course, because it flies in the face of our Western individual culture. It tells us that we should be self-reliant, that it's all about our rights and our dreams and our personal choice and our accumulation of personal wealth. There's nothing wrong with being rich, plenty of rich people in the early church. But the sort of identification with a group of believers which considered wealth to be a more common shared and mutual possession rather than simply belonging to an individual. Wow, that's a phenomenal, amazing culture and massively challenging. It just makes my heart skip a beat when I think about it. I think, wow, that's amazing. In fact, if I'm really honest, the whole thought of belonging to a authentic, real, mutual community is both attractive and it's also weirdly, strangely terrifying. Because I want the things, like we want the things that authentic community brings, right? We want the joy and we want the companionship and we want the connection. We want to be in a community that's there for each other and prays together and gives sacrificially and spends time together. And I really want to be in a community that is so impacts the world that it's this massive signpost to Jesus and many are added to the number of the church daily. But it also does something else to me because I know that a community like that requires me to be real and authentic. And that's a bit scary because if I'm real and authentic before you, what happens if you don't see? What happens if you don't like what you see? What happens if you look at me and you judge me and you reject me and I have to deal with all that rejection? So there's a bit of me that like, do you know what? It's easier to keep our relationship superficial and for me to withdraw and to protect myself. The Christian psychiatrist Scott Peck in his book Preaching Through a Storm says this, there can be no vulnerability without risk. And there can be no true community without vulnerability. The other thing is, communities that are raw and real and authentic give sacrificially, and not just of material possessions, which I like to have around me because it makes me feel secure. They give of themselves, of their time, of their effort, of their thought, of their resources. And they do it in a way that benefits others and it's not about benefiting me. So I show up in the room not because of what I can get out of it, but because of what I can contribute to everybody else that's there. And it's actually about them and not just about me. And I look at my faith levels and I think, God, do I even have faith to belong to a community that is that sacrificial, that self-sacrificing? Can I ever even see that happening? And if I'm not careful, I begin to think that this is all about me just needing to do a little bit more, just needing to work a little bit harder, just needing to commit a little bit more to the life of my community. Because I know, like, I have limits, right? And I don't want to be exhausted. I don't want to exhaust those limits. My friends and family don't want to do that either. Surely it can't just be about working harder. So how did the church, the early church, have such a radical sacrificial community? And are there lessons that I can learn from this passage I can apply to my own life that will eventually make a difference? Well, I think there are. So come on, we'll have another look and delve further into Acts. We are told that the early church devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. And at that time, the apostles' teaching would have been focused on that resurrected Jesus. The Jesus who was born in Bethlehem and who lived his life and who did miracles and teaching and who was crucified and was raised from the dead. This Jesus who fulfilled ancient prophecies and the hopes and dreams of a nation. They would have heard about Jesus who walked amongst the poor and who had compassion on them. A man who lived with care and with empathy, who looked after the needy and defended the weak. And whose death was the ultimate act of sacrificial love. Jesus Christ, who was himself born into a family, lived in a community, and when it came to starting his ministry, he gathered a community around himself and lived in the midst of a brotherhood of disciples. The very same Jesus who lives within a community of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And in whose image every one of us is made. And they would have seen only too well in the life of Jesus what true community looked like. A.W. Tozer, in his amazing book, The Pursuit of God, can't recommend this book enough. If you've never read it, please read it. It's great. He says this about community life. Has it ever occurred to you that 100 pianos all tuned by the same fork are automatically tuned to each other? They are of one accord, not by being tuned to each other, but another standard to which they must bow. Our devotion to Christ binds us in unity like nothing else. It focuses us together, our hearts and our minds. And by focusing always and keeping Christ at the centre of our faith, it will help us on our journey towards authentic community more than anything else. The second thing to notice about this passage is that it happened chronologically just after Pentecost, when people were gathered, see, together again in that room, and the Holy Spirit comes and he brings comfort and he brings power and he brings authority and he brings peace and he brings courage. There is a passage in Romans 8 that says that one of the roles of the Holy Spirit is to testify with our spirit, to tell us, to convince us in our spirit that we are children of God. And this is really important as we consider how we grow in community. Because as we become more aware of who we are, our identity as beloved children of God, what we receive is acceptance and security. It's a thing that our heart longs for. It's the thing that connection with God really brings. And that, of course, acceptance and security, is the very opposite of the things that battle within us, that cause us to shy away from community. Our fear of rejection and our insecurities. And I do wonder if the early church, who were filled with the Holy Spirit, were so convinced about their place and identity before Father God that they were able to overcome their fears of rejection and become truly authentic and honest and real with each other. I want to suggest that the work of the Holy Spirit is a foundational aspect in us being able to function as true, authentic community. And if you really want to know how the Holy Spirit impacts community, just look at Galatians 5, where you'll find the fruit of the Spirit: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, all those things. And imagine what community would function like if those things thrived. So a truly authentic community is born out of our devotion to the risen Christ and being filled with the Holy Spirit, gifts of grace that are granted to us, and which we ourselves can never earn and can't and did not deserve. However, does that imply that it requires nothing of us? Is it all just that we let it all happen around us? Do we actually have no place in this at all? Well, that's of course not true. Because from the beginning of time, even in the Garden of Eden, it was the heart of God that he partnered with us to build community, to grow community, to work together, to have a community and a culture that represented heaven on earth. If we look back in Acts chapter 2, the key there is in the word devoted. They devoted themselves. This word in the original language has two meanings. It's made up of two separate words, actually. The word towards and the word to be strong. So it's like to be strong towards, to have effort towards, to continuously, steadfastly press into something would be the way that we would describe it today. So that verse may mean they made an effort towards or were strong towards the apostles' teaching and fellowship and the breaking of bread and prayer. And I do suspect that some of the energy for all that came from the joy and the companionship and the thankfulness that existed within the community. Part of my role here at God First is to help cultivate the small groups and the communities within the life of the church. We call them connect groups. And one of the great things is that I get to hear some great stories that come out of those groups. I'm going to share one of them with you today. I heard a story that when the whole lockdown thing was kind of looming, a lot of our connect group leaders across the church decided they would explore the digital world, you know, WhatsApp and Zoom and such as like, so they could find ways of keeping connection going with people. I heard of one group leader that had sent out various invitations and had continuously not heard back from one particular person. So this connect group leader left their house, went to the house of the other person, knocked on the door, stood several feet back, and when they opened the door, said to them, "Where have you been? Why haven't you responded to the invitations? We need you to keep connection. We need to be in this together. How can we love and support each other if you're not there?" When I heard that story, it was a puddle. I was like, that is amazing. Because not only did that leader recognise the importance of community, they went out and they fought for it. Sometimes, in order for us to have real and authentic community, we actually have to press into it, to fight for it, and to go for it, to bring effort to it, and to strive to reach it. To be strong towards it, the scripture says. So in the next few weeks, as we continue to explore the book of Acts and we look at the early church and we grapple with some of the foundational elements that laid the very foundations that the church is built on, I want to suggest you remember that community is right there at the heart of it, along with prayer and communion and witness. But you know what is astonishing? I was thinking, that church that we've been looking at, that church that was compassionate and gave and was raw and authentic and real with each other, that church that was a signpost to Jesus so that many were added to them. You know, that's us, right? You know, we are that church. I know that we live in a different age. I know we live in a different culture. I know we live in a different place. But in the end, the elements that make the church what she is, who she is, are the same today as they were back then. The centrality of Christ, the presence of the Holy Spirit, the family of brothers and sisters who belong to God. That being the case, we are perfectly capable of living as God always intended. We are perfectly capable of being that amazing church. We already have elements of it amongst us, but we are so capable of being that amazing church, regardless of what society tells us, regardless where our fears take us. I'd love it if we closed our eyes just for a few minutes, even opened your hands and opened your heart. I'm going to invite the Holy Spirit to come. The Holy Spirit is always here. Wherever we're gathered, he's with us, he's in us, he's part of who we are. But sometimes he comes with fresh revelation. And that's what I'm going to pray today. that the Holy Spirit would come with fresh revelation for you wherever you are. If you've been watching this and you've been astonished because you actually have not heard this stuff before, you don't know who this Jesus is, it's not the Jesus who you thought, he isn't who you thought he was, the church is not what you thought she was, and you want to step towards the church and you want to step towards Jesus and know more about him, then I would encourage you to get in touch with us, either on our website or I think there's a little button on the corner of the screen. Just get in touch with us. We would love to help you explore this more, and we would love to see you added to our number. And if you're a member of God First or a member of another church, I just want you to be aware of the Holy Spirit now and what he may be saying to you, and whether in this time he has said things to your heart, things that will help you step towards greater community. Maybe it's some of the things that have stopped you over the years. Maybe it's your understanding of the centrality of Jesus, or maybe the Holy Spirit, or maybe your fears or insecurities, or maybe you've been influenced by what the West has told us the church community and social life should be in this day. Let's ask the Holy Spirit to bring fresh revelation to you. Help you understand who you really are. God, thank you that you formed us for community. You made us that way, God. And we are made in your image. Please help us to be all that your heart desires us to be. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, thank you, Shirley, for unpacking that wonderful truth and those wonderful truths out of Acts 2 there, and helping us as a church to make sure we keep building on strong foundations. Brilliant. Thank you so much. Really, really helpful. I just want to pray for us now and see if the Lord wants to do anything else with us by Spirit. Just because we're not physically present doesn't mean God can't encounter us. And so let's just pray and take a couple of moments to allow God to just touch our lives, fill us with his Spirit, and say anything specific to us. So Lord, we come to you right now and we thank you for this moment where we've been able to worship, where we've been able to hear about what it means to scatter, Lord God, into our communities, bringing change, Lord God, as agents of your kingdom. Thank you that the truth of the word has been unpacked for us as Shirley has opened that. Lord, I pray it resonate in our hearts, and I pray that you just come upon us by your Spirit right now in Jesus' name. I just see a door being opened and there's light behind it. And I believe that the Lord would say this, for some of us here, it's felt like hopelessness has crowded in. And the Lord wants to remind you that he's a God full of hope. And when the light comes, the darkness cannot remain. And so when the light comes, it's instant. It floods the darkness and there's hope. The Lord wants to impart hope to you right now by the Holy Spirit. Others here, I believe that the Lord wants to bring healing right now in the name of Jesus. And so I believe for some, it's specific mental health challenges that you're finding now, that depression has crowded in. The Lord wants to just come right now and connect with that word around hope, wants to lift depression now, wants to lift anxiety, sleeplessness, where it's crept in. The Lord wants to deal with that right now and bring his grace and healing right now. I believe that pain in bodies is going to go right now. I believe that particularly for some, there's leg pain, sciatic pain that the Lord wants to heal. So why don't you just come and receive by his Holy Spirit, receive him close with you as we play out this song. Click the live prayer button to get the prayer team to pray with you. If you need anything, salvation, healing, breakthrough, hope, the Lord is here for you and our team are here for you, and we'd love to pray for you. So God bless you into this week. May you know his strength, his grace, his blessing upon you and his anointing, and him close to you this week. God bless you. See you again soon.
make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. Lord, turn his face toward you and give you peace. The Lord bless you and keep you, make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace.
From heaven, this isn't second guessing. We know that we are protected. May the peace that surpasses all understanding be our message. Grace and favors in your nature, in your essence.
May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations,
and your family, and your children,
and the children, and the children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations.
Children,
and the children.